of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Good morning. It is a pleasure to be back with you, especially on this beautiful Easter morning. And I would like to thank Wayne and Addison for helping me with my sermon this morning. Understanding that a struggle is going on, a fierce struggle within us and seemingly all around us. A struggle to get what we want in life, all the while others are doing the very same thing. There is conflict, sometimes quietly beneath the surface, in your face with those around us at other times, as we all negotiate for what we need, what we think we need. Yes, what we think we need indeed. We seem to have many needs. We seem to have many needs because somewhere along the line, most of us listened to voices that told us we don't have it all together. We begin to believe that we lack what it takes, and at the same time become convinced that somehow you can provide it for me. Whether it is from a parent, a lover, a mentor, a friend, even an inanimate object, you have something I think I need. And so the negotiation, the strategizing begins. I may be lonely. I may lack financial resources. I may need to be needed. Or in the face of my insecurity, I need you to reassure me that I do, in fact, have it all together. So you can help me with all of that. You have what I think I need, and therefore you are integral to my happiness or a potential source of my unhappiness. So the struggle ramps up. This same struggle gets played out between groups. Groups that seem to meet their needs by competing for limited benefits, political clout, money, social influence. The struggle might get taken into the media and can become very damaging. Let's take the struggle up another notch to nations. And we have armed conflict. You have what I think I need. And if you don't provide it, prepare for the worst. As a result of all of this, we can be at war with a spouse, a friend, a town government, or the country next door. If they have what I need and I'm not getting it, we struggle, we fight. This conflict, this struggle within each of us can feel like a powerful kingdom. A kingdom that seems to rule over us, influencing our thinking, poisoning our hearts. And this Easter day, just like all other Easter days, reminds us that this need not be. This need not be. Jesus came with the message, the good news, that the choice is ours. The choice is ours. We can choose a different kingdom. With the power of Jesus and his resurrection, we can say no to the illusional kingdom of Satan, which has us believing that we are less than. With Jesus and a resurrection power that is also ours, we can return to the knowledge, return to the belief that in Christ we are one with all things. With Jesus beside us, we can turn our backs. We can turn our backs and walk away from a kingdom which tempts us to believe we are unworthy and inadequate. God bless you, Addison. We can return to our true God-created selves, one with Christ, one with each other, one with God the Father.
Gonna break though we bring your gift.
is all about choosing. Choosing again. The power of the resurrection to choose again. Turning away from Satan's delusional kingdom, we can do this. We can make this choice. Our choice for Jesus to be our teacher and guide is what we choose. Together, we boldly face that kingdom which seems to suck the life out of us. With Jesus as our companion and friend, we trust him to open our hearts and minds. With hearts and minds open to God, our oneness with Jesus, our oneness with each other, our oneness with God, now becomes our ongoing Easter experience. As we practice choosing again, Jesus invites us to be watchful. If we are going to let Jesus in, and as we change our hearts and minds, we need to look at a few things. With Jesus by our side, we need to look at and recognize the ways we have chosen the kingdom that seems to have enslaved us. With Jesus, we look at how we have chosen feelings of irritation and anger that seem to imprison us. We look with Jesus at how we have chosen any kind of resistance to things that are unfolding around us. With Jesus, we vigilantly look at the myriad ways that fear has been our chosen pattern. Finally, we recognize with Jesus how we have blamed others for all of the above, and with him, begin to look at the endless judgments we have made, judgments that are never ending, judgments we are convinced are self-righteously warranted. We look and see that our choice for Satan's kingdom is very costly indeed. The good news of the resurrection is that Jesus simply asks that we look at all of this. We don't need to try to change anything. We don't need to fight against and resist our fearful selves. We simply need to look at it all. We look with Jesus throughout each day at the ways in which I have chosen a kingdom, in which I am justified in holding grudges. We look at the ways I have chosen a kingdom where I put my own needs first and foremost. A kingdom I have chosen in which I seek to control events around me. A kingdom I have chosen which teaches that my sister or my brother is different and separate from me. And as a result, if I am honest, they are pretty hard to trust. We need to look at all this with Jesus. It is this practice of looking at how we have chosen Satan's kingdom that takes the power out of this disastrous delusion. When we look with Jesus at the power of Satan's kingdom, his kingdom begins to wane and dissolve as we practice recognizing moments when we have chosen the wrong teacher. As we practice, as we look again, we begin to see ourselves, others, and all that is going on around us with Jesus' vision, and that makes all the difference. But if you are like me, you are not going to want to look at all of this stuff. You are not going to want to honestly confront all of this very difficult subject matter. The pain of guilt will seem to get the better of us as we begin to look at all of this that is sometimes overwhelming and within us. So, Satan's kingdom is going to look a lot more attractive than the work of looking at the ways we think we have messed up, hurt other people, chased after what is harmful to us. Because this looking feels entrenched with guilt and pain and heartache, the temptation will be to slide back into old patterns of conflict and struggle and heartache, to fall prey once again to patterns that on the surface seem less painful, patterns that are not flooded with this deeply felt guilt. The temptation will be to return to a choice for Satan's kingdom, a return to hell. And that's okay. Jesus will wait. It's okay. It's okay to backslide. We're all doing the very best. Patiently, Jesus remains at our side, waiting to gently love, to forgive, and to cheer us on in spite of all the silly things we believe about ourselves and others. Jesus waits with smiling face. My brother, my sister, don't take your crazy baloney so seriously. Tell me about it. Look at it with me, and slowly it will fall away as we practice looking together. My peace will become your way of looking at all things, no matter what is going on around you. Jesus forgave his disciples and his torturers and the judges who sent him to his death because he knew they know not what they do. He knew that their actions were a call for love. Fear. Extreme fear and guilt were motivating these folks to do unspeakable things. Jesus knew who these women and men really were. Children of the Heavenly Father. And Jesus knew he was completely and always safe within the arms of his Father. All the actors in the Holy Week drama were simply crying out for love. Jesus knows all this about us too. We are either acting out of a reflection of his love or calling for love. It is okay with Jesus if we continue to choose the wrong teacher. His love and non-judgmental kindness will never change. He just asks that we look at this choice, this mistaken choice, with him. To be honest and say, Jesus, I don't want you as my teacher right now. I am still too afraid. I am too afraid to come to you just as I am. We admit this to our loving companion and friend, and he says, come anyway. Come, just the way you are. And then he takes our hand, leading us more and more each day in and the power of the resurrection, to see what he sees. All of God's children, most assuredly, in resurrection